production. Since we all see, regularly see a lot of hypertension and diabetes cases, and many times these patients will also be having some endocrine disorders. The diabetes part will be managed by a physician, endocrine part will be co-managed by endocrinologist. That's a very common scenario. I thought I will explore the various conditions where these two coexist. There is a core endocrine disorder and there is either hypertension or diabetes. Some relevant aspects of such disorders we will go through today in brief. So this can be approached in 2-3 ways. Does uncontrolled endocrine function lead to refractory dysglycemia, either hyperglycemia or hypoglycemia? Or on the other hand, whether diabetes itself can affect the evaluation or treatment of an endocrine disorder. So this can happen both ways. Many times, the drugs we give for glucose control may adversely or positively impact endocrine function, or the drugs we give to control the endocrine problem may adversely impact the diabetic function. Due to shortage of time, I will be dealing with only the first part of the 4 questions. So let's start with a starter. She is a 12 years old girl, recently detected diabetes. Some modest weight loss was 2-3 kilogram. Doctor noticed some mild coarsening of faces. She was of average height for the parents. There was some cough hypertrophy, some kind of lapse of fat, subcutaneous fat. So what could be the possible differential diagnosis for such a case? Young lady without ketosis, without any emergency presentation, recent diabetes, some mild coarsening of faces. So,
glycogen disorder.
Okay, then.
Lipodystrophy.
Anorexia. So, a lot of TDs spring up with such a presentation. So the HbA1c was 10.5, she was non-obese, no family history, no ketosis. At first look, she apparently has coarse feces and prominent cough. So these were the differentials considered at the first presentation. Even though she did not have ketosis, because of her lean stature and some weight loss, sometimes type 1 diabetes doesn't present in abrupt fashion, but rather develops over 1 or 2 months. So this was that it is initially considered across agentism, type 1 diabetes and lipodystrophy. Her C-peptide reserve was good and GAD antibody was negative. Because of suspicion about GH, excess GH was done, IGF was done. GH was high and IGF-1 was within normal limit. So again, it was not very straightforward biochemical wise. She was put on, we thought, okay, we will start her on therapy, observe the growth pattern, then go for a final diagnosis. So she responded excellently to metformin plus pioglitazone. Since there was suspicion, clinical suspicion of lipodystrophy, pioglitazone was added. Without any insulin, she responded excellently because we dared to go without insulin because of excellent C-peptide reserve and GAD antibody negativity. So this is it is in such cases that we have to think about the coexistence of 2 disorders and same disorder presenting to different people in different fashion. Uncontrolled diabetes itself induces GH resistant state, and in such cases GH will be high. GH has to act on liver to produce IGF-1. In GH resistance, the GH will be high, but even high normal GH will not be enough to produce average level of IGF-1. So GH will be high, but IGF-1 will be within normal range. Such cases will not have increase in height, but they may manifest metabolic symptoms due to high GH. So PM can cause confusion in acromegaly diagnosis. The GH excess itself can cause lipolysis because growth independent metabolic effects can happen because of high GH. So GH excess causes lipolysis and increased hepatic glucose output, so it may worsen the hyperglycemic scenario. Medications targeting insulin resistance are a good initial choice till diagnosis is found out. So these are the 4 things happening in the body with regards to glucose disposal. We can see the 4 processes listed here: glycogenolysis, glycogenesis, glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. We always have wanted to forget these four terms after breaking stage over because it is so taxing on our free thinking brain. But it becomes very crucial to bring up this process again in order to understand what happens in each endocrine disorder. It's very simple to put up in such format. Glycogen broken down into glucose 6-phosphate, that is glycogenolysis. The reverse process, glycogen synthesis from glucose and glucose 6-phosphate, is glycogenesis. So the top half is very clear. The bottom half of the picture, the glycolysis is just breaking down, or the glucose is put through metabolism to generate pyruvate. Pyruvate is an intermediary factor for production of so many things. It can be channeled into fatty acid synthesis through acetyl-CoA. It can be channeled into, again, glucose synthesis by liver through gluconeogenesis, new glucose production, gluconeogenesis. So these four processes keep happening in our body all the time. So as I told, the bottom half of the picture we can see pyruvate is converted into acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA is a central molecule for many processes, citric acid cycle, fatty acid synthesis. So many things happen with acetyl-CoA, even for energy generation. So endocrine conditions coexist with or can worsen diabetic status. Attempts to detect endocrine conditions at an earlier stage, we have to start looking for subtle clues and biochemical changes. So few of the endocrine disorders I will list out and try to briefly explain what happens. Hyperthyroidism we very frequently see. Insulin resistance is the prominent active phenomenon. There is increased intestinal glucose absorption and increased hepatic glucose production. So predominantly it is insulin resistant state. Insulin secretion itself is preserved. So ideal treatment for a mild diabetes along with antithyroid treatment will be those insulin sensitizers predominantly. We can use gliptins also, because gliptins, we know, it works on both alpha cell and beta cell. Through alpha cell effect, it decreases the glucagon, decreases the insulin resistance. So or pioglitazone for a short duration, or gliptins for the time being, are a good initial choice for hyperthyroidism related hyperglycemia. There are few advanced molecules coming up, something like TR-beta agonist, which works only on liver to suppress the glucagon effect. They are not available yet for clinical use. On the other hand, hypothyroidism, there is decrease in release of glucose from the liver, so there is a higher chance for hypoglycemia. The third common but generally missed problem is hyperparathyroidism. In hyperparathyroidism, clue will be patients may be having osteoporosis, bony pain, fracture with trivial trauma. The clue in lab reports will be high calcium and low phosphorus. That will be the clue to diagnosis, further workup. What happens if the intracellular calcium is high? The cell is unable to, the cell surface glucose transporters are unable to allow excess glucose into the within the cell. So there is a delay in glucose dispersal from the bloodstream, away from the bloodstream. So surgery for parathyroidoma cures hyperglycemia in this case. So the picture looks a bit complex. I will try to, we can focus on the red box here. This is regarding Cushing syndrome. We all commonly use steroid. This applies to both exogenous Cushing's, where we commonly use steroid for many conditions. Allergy, rheumatoid arthritis, bronchial asthma exacerbation, and also to endogenous Cushing's. What happens? Gluconeogenesis is increased. The muscle protein is broken down. Alanine is taken from the amino acid. It is taken down from the muscle protein. It is channeled into liver to produce new glucose, gluconeogenesis. So that's the process which is predominant in Cushing syndrome. So there are some subtle differences how we handle diabetes in Cushing syndrome. In general, we have to consider avoiding pioglitazone because it may exacerbate the weight gain. Also, avoiding SGLT2 inhibitor is a good choice in this situation, because Cushing syndrome in general is an immunosuppressed state. Any SGLT2 inhibitor, even a non-severe UTA, can frequently pass on to become a very severe upper UTA. So better to stick with metformin, cefalonuria, gliptins, or insulin in this case. The top two agents preferably avoid. So slightly different phenomenon happens in pheochromocytoma. Here what happens, instead of protein, the glucose production is channeled from the fatty acid for adipose tissue. The fat tissue is broken down, fatty acids are channeled through gluconeogenesis to produce glucose. In addition, insulin release from beta cell is also inhibited. So here, theoretically, mechanistically, we have a case for introducing insulin early in the course of therapy. So here again, we have to consider avoiding SGLT2 inhibitor, because SGLT2 inhibitor, if enough fluids are not taken, it produces a relative hypovolemic state. Pheochromocytoma is already a volume contracted state, so we have to preferably avoid SGLT2 inhibitor. Other agents may be used in this case. Hyperaldosteronism. Nowadays, Western literature shows that up to 10% of hypertensive population may be having some form of hyperaldosteronism. It may be subtle, it may be florid. In this, it is not related to insulin resistance, but rather related to impaired beta cell insulin release. Simply correcting potassium will improve the insulin release. Or if the patient is having resistant hypertension, if you add aldosterone antagonist like spironolactone, that will improve potassium and will subsequently improve the beta cell insulin release. Or surgery, you can go for either of these modalities. So the etiological diagnosis definitely helps us in choosing the better alternative from among the antidiabetic drugs. Or sometimes even drug may not be required, simply correct the alkaline abnormality, the insulin secreting defect is bound to correct following that. In PCOS, we all very frequently see 10-15% of marriageable age ladies have PCOS. So there is peripheral as well as liver resistance to insulin, excess insulin in circulation. This insulin works on the TFA cell and produces more ovarian androgen. So the symptoms follow, oligomenorrhea, mild hirsutism, all these things follow. Obesity generally is part of PCOS picture. It is an insulin resistant state. Metformin is the first choice drug. Suppose if family is completed, patient is not very obese, then pioglitazone is also a very good choice, because this is also a good insulin sensitizer. So if family is completed, we can consider pioglitazone also. So just a summary of all the things that we went through. Two or three conditions predominantly affect the insulin secretion, like hyperaldosteronism, pheochromocytoma, and probably long-standing acromegaly. Most of the other endocrine conditions work on worsening the insulin sensitivity, like hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, Cushing's, pheo, hyperparathyroidism, etc. So just a summary of what would be the good initial drug. Eventually, in a given patient, we may have to use 3 or 4 drugs, but here the discussion is about the preferred initial drug. So hypothyroidism, metformin is a very good drug. If we consider weight gain as a problem issue, then pioglitazone probably we have to avoid. Hyperthyroidism, SGLT2 inhibitor better to avoid, because it is already a volume contracted state. Hyperaldosteronism, potassium correction itself can correct the insulin secretion defect. Cushing's, better to avoid pioglitazone. Pheochromocytoma, better to avoid SGLT2 inhibitor. And hyperparathyroidism, again a volume contracted state will worsen hypercalcemia. So from that point of view, better to avoid SGLT2 inhibitor. Also, Invokana has propensity to decrease the bone density. 1 year, 2 year studies are available. So certain SGLT2 inhibitors are deleterious for, possibly deleterious for bone health. They should be specifically avoided. So whom to screen for endocrine causes? Anyone after birth, we keep seeing lot of diabetes hypertension cases. Hypertension in young, diabetes in young without any family history, diabetes in young who is losing or gaining weight disproportionately, something out of sorts. Low potassium or high calcium is noted. Or in case of Cushing's or acromegaly, the faces will give a clue. So summary, diabetes and hypertension are very common. Since we happen to see so many cases, we are bound to miss subtle cases of endocrine cause of diabetes if we don't specifically look for it. So hidden among routine diabetes and high BP patients will be cases with specific endocrine issues. Specific treatment most often cures diabetes in such patients. Careful history, physical exam, and specific lab evaluation, we need not do a mass cell checkup, just one or two extra tests will help identify such cases. Thank you for patience. Possibly a teratogenic agent. So while it is very good for decreasing insulin resistance, it is excellent drug for PCOS per se. But PCOS with infertility or aiming for future conception, it should not be used. So if family is completed, then only the metabolic issue is the only issue, not the fertility problem, then we can use. Because of teratogens, that's the only.
High sodium intake, which linked to metabolic disorders.
Well, there is as such, no, I am not aware of any diagram. Any particular thing you want to wish to
know? We talked about hyperaldosteronism,
potassium. There is a subset, there is a in-between subset between the usual systemic hypertension, that the essential hypertension, and hyperaldosteronism. There is an intermediate diagnosis called salt sensitive hypertension, where the aldosterone level is not very high, but in such cases, if you give extra salt, suddenly the BP control goes out of control. You may have to use even 3-4 drugs in that case. So, such cases, it's not very clearly defined. It is, in older textbooks, it is called salt sensitive hypertension. But in modern terminology, there is no specific name given for that. Probably it is all considered part of that spectrum. Somewhere in between essential hypertension, but not at aldosterone adenoma. Somewhere in between it falls. So such cases, probably we should focus on restricting salt intake.
In hypothyroidism, you suggest metformin first line of
drug. Yes.
Apart from metformin, what other drug do you suggest?
Pioglitazone we can use. Weight is not an issue, pioglitazone we can use. These are all recommendations for the initial drug. It's not that that is the only drug that should be used. So we can go for other drugs also if you are particularly fond of that drug and if it suits the purpose.
Sulfonylureas
very well we can use, but it's not controlled with diabetes, it's not controlled with metformin. You can very well use sulfonylurea, no harm with that. But metformin should be the ideal initial drug.
Initial metformin.
Request Dr. Srinivas.
Yeah, please.